Primary biliary cholangitis is a chronic inflammation of the bile ducts, probably with an autoimmune background. Signs of cholestasis often lead to diagnosis. For most patients, there is an effective treatment.
Primary biliary cholangitis, abbreviated PBC, is a chronic granulomatous liver disease affecting the smallest of the bile ducts, so only visible on liver biopsy under the microscope. It's a rather benign liver disease, only causing real problems in a minority of our patients. But on the other hand, this disease may affect quality of life in a vast majority of our patients.
The prevalence of primary biliary cholangitis in Europe is 40 to 80 per 100,000. Generally, the onset of the disease is between the 4th and 6th decades of life. 90% of patients are female. Most patients remain asymptomatic for a long time, but there is a creeping destruction of the small bile ducts taking place, which sooner or later becomes symptomatic. The biliary damage can progress to cirrhosis in the long term.
Usually, PBC takes benign course, only very rarely causing liver cirrhosis and complications of liver cirrhosis. Most of the patients really do have a benign course that can be controlled well over many, many years and decades. Typical symptoms of patients with PBC are fatigue, and this can be really draining fatigue that patients may get up in the morning and really feel as if they haven't been sleeping at all. Some patients do have arthralgias, joint pain. Some also suffer from malaise. This is not very frequent. And some patients even suffer from pruritus. Many patients do experience symptoms of dry eye, dry mucous membrane, so-called sicca syndrome. This can be very bothersome for the patient with dry, itchy, and sometimes also tearing eyes and recurrent urinary tract infections due to genital dry mucous membranes. And we really recommend to seek the ophthalmologist and sometimes also gynecologist in order to receive proper treatment for dry mucous membranes, both for the eye, genital or urinary, and sometimes even needed within mouth and nose. So it is important to know that the intensity of the symptoms is not related to the extent of actual liver disease. That means we do see patients with very little liver disease and very severe symptoms, and vice versa.
PBC is diagnosed based on a combination of criteria. There are elevated liver enzymes, especially the cholestatic parameters GGT and AP. By definition, these have to be elevated for more than 6 months. Lab changes that may also be found are elevated levels of cholesterol and IgM. The other criteria are detection of autoantibodies and histological findings. The diagnosis of PBC requires at least two of these three criteria.
Autoantibodies play a crucial role in the diagnosis of PBC. We do find elevated autoantibodies really in almost all patients. The vast majority will display antibodies targeting mitochondria, the so-called anti-mitochondrial autoantibodies. In a smaller proportion of our patients, we will find anti-nuclear autoantibodies targeting specific nuclear antigens, especially SP100, which makes a nuclear dot pattern upon immunofluorescence diagnostics, antibodies targeting GP210, which makes a nuclear rim pattern upon IFT, and also centromere antibodies, which really do make the typical centromere pattern on IFT. And all these together, four different autoantibodies, are quite typical for PBC patients. If you do not find any of these autoantibodies, it is probably necessary to perform liver biopsy to be really sure of the diagnosis of PBC in your patient.
Histology shows cholangitis of interlobular and septal bile ducts. There are focal lesions with marked pericanalicular inflammation, necrosis, and granuloma formation. These are called florid bile duct lesions and are nearly pathognomonic of PBC.
Liver histology is indicated in those patients where you do not have the typical autoantibodies, and it is also indicated if you do suspect a variant syndrome of PBC, that is additional presence of autoimmune hepatitis.
If PBC is diagnosed, sonography is indicated initially to exclude other obstructive bile duct diseases. Abdominal lymph nodes are present in up to 97% of cases. However, there are no specific ultrasound findings. Non-invasive elastography of the liver helps to determine the disease stage. It proves a good correlation with the stage of liver fibrosis and PBC.
The risk for osteoporosis is greatly increased in patients with PBC. Why that is, we are not quite sure. But we do recommend that all patients with a diagnosis of PBC do undergo osteodensitometry in order to early diagnose possible osteoporosis and properly treat early osteoporosis.
Standard therapy for people diagnosed with PBC is the physiological bile acid or sodeoxycholic acid taken orally on a permanent basis at a dosage of 13 to 15 milligrams per kilogram of body weight. UDCA is usually well tolerated. The therapy significantly prolongs transplant-free survival in advanced stages. Patients with early PBC who tolerate UDCA well have a risk of one day needing a liver transplant that is comparable to healthy people. Second-line therapy in case of insufficient response to UDCA includes obeticholic acid and bezafibrate.
Some patients may not develop full clinical remission, that is normalization of the liver enzymes upon standard treatment with ursodeoxycholic acid. And in the last few years, we've had great developments in the pharmaceutical treatment of these patients. So we do know that drugs targeting bile acid receptors within the liver, for example, obeticholic acid or bezafibrate, may improve liver enzymes in these patients. Especially bezafibrate is a drug that also have the potential to ameliorate the extent of pruritus in many patients, albeit it is off-label and not licensed for the use in PBC in most European countries.
As quality of life may be reduced significantly by symptoms such as pruritus or Sika syndrome, symptomatic treatment is highly important. If topical treatment of pruritus is insufficient, systemic medications should be explored. Cholestyramine, rifampicin, and naltrexone are proven substances. Sika symptoms may be treated by tear substitutes or parasympathetic comimetics. In cases of xerostomia, there are several options to stimulate salivation.
The fatigue component of PBC is very difficult to treat. Coffee is allowed. We do not have proper drugs to treat fatigue right now. And also, we do recommend adaptation of lifestyle. For example, a nap in between different tasks in the middle of the day, which often improves quality of life and the extent of fatigue quite a bit in our patients.
Liver transplantation is only necessary for primary biliary cholangitis if, despite therapy, the disease progresses to decompensated cirrhosis or if symptoms such as itching become intolerable. In 75% of cases, PBC is permanently cured by transplantation. In one quarter, PBC damage reappears in the transplant.
We do know that many more drugs are to be developed in near future, and clinical studies are running both for pruritus in PBC, but also for the treatment of PBC itself, especially in biochemical non-responders. And please try to include your patients that have bad pruritus or even that do not respond perfectly to monotherapy with ursodeoxycholic acid into clinical studies to really improve research in this very important area of medicine. Within the European reference networks, we have the great opportunity to discuss patients with difficult to treat PBC who may not respond fully to standard treatment or even combined treatment with colleagues, with great colleagues within the European Union. This is really great for our patients and leads to a much better treatment of our patients. And please use the opportunity to discuss difficult patients within our CPMS system. And please post your questions and we will all be happy to answer and discuss with you.